stand up. We'll pray and worship our awesome God. Lord, we do want to come before you right now, God, just thanking you so much for your grace that covers us, your love, Lord, that embraces us. Lord, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for offering your one and only Son for us. Thank you that Jesus is alive. Lord, we thank you that you inhabit us, God, and you live inside of us. And Lord, we just want to take some time right now to just pour out our hearts to you and tell you that we love you. As your children, we want to worship you and adore you for the gracious, good, compassionate, loving God you are. Enable us to do that, God. Open our eyes up, open our ears up to see you and to hear you. Be enthroned on our praises, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. No better word.
No better word than from your lips. No perfect life than what you lived. No greater gift, no, not one. No brighter stars in your shield. No better hope for all mankind. No higher mind, no, not one. This kind of love you show, there has never been a greater love than your Son, no, not one, and there will never be a name above. With his life you have forgiven us, hope has come, hope has come, and there will never be a greater love, no, not one. No simple word can match your name. No high fame, no, not no one's ever seen. No one has ever known, seen the depth of your majesty. There has never been a greater love than your Son, no, not one, and there will never be a name above. You have forgiven us. Hope has come, hope has come, and there will never be a greater love, no, not one.
No greater call,
no greater call.
No greater call.
You gave us all a reason to live. No greater love,
no greater love.
You gave us all a reason to give. No greater love.
No greater love.
You gave us all a reason to shine. No greater love. Forever mine. There has never been a greater love than your Son. No, not one. And there will never be a name above. No, not one. With his life you have forgiven us. Hope has come, hope has come, and there will never be.
There is none like you, God. You are glorious, Lord. You are everything, God, we could ever want and ever need. It's you, God. The great I am, it's you. So heaven is real and death is a lie. I want to hear voices, angels above, singing as one. Hallelujah, holy, holy, God Almighty, the great I am, who is worthy. None beside thee, God Almighty, the great I am. I want to be near, near to your heart, loving the world, hating the dark. I want to see dry bones living again. Singing as one, hallelujah, holy, holy, God Almighty, the great I am, who is worthy, there's none beside thee, God Almighty, the great I am. Shake before him, the demons run and flee at the mention of the name King of Majesty. There is no power in hell or any who can stand before the power and the presence of the great I am. Hallelujah. Holy Lord. Praise you, Lord.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You are living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. Heartbeat comes free, and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, glory of your goodness. Let us become
Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Oh, Lord, this is our prayer, God. Lord, open our eyes and our ears, God, again, God, please let us become aware of how you are with us all the time. You have promised to never leave us or forsake us or abandon us. We are never alone. Thank you that you are with us, and help us to just see the sweet messages of love that you send to us every day to remind us that you do love us. Let us take note, God, of the way the birds sing, or the way the sky looks, God, or the way our children speak or sing, or whatever it is, God, our grandparents. Lord, just let us be aware of your goodness and your love and your presence. We don't want to miss anything, God. And we pray, Lord, that you would fill our cups up to overflow with your Spirit, that you would teach us by your Holy Spirit this morning through the opening of your word. Thank you that we have this opportunity. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to say good morning to your neighbors.
You're good.
Good morning, church. It's a blessing to see you all here today. We have an announcement from Noreen to start off with, so I'll let her take the stage here.
Hi, I'm Noreen. Good morning. Okay. My first announcement is for women's ministry. We did something called Summer Sisters this summer, and so on August 28th at 7 p.m., we're having our final Summer Sisters get together. So come with those of you that did it, come with your sisters, come ready to share what the Lord did during those times and how he ministered to you and the fun you guys had, or how much you didn't meet together, because I know some ladies didn't get to meet together, but come anyways. And bring a homemade baked good with you and your Bible. Okay, also, children's ministry. Last time I was up here, I had the cute little, I don't want to call them minions, but you know, they were the cute little ones, and they stole the show, and I didn't really get to tell you what I need in children's ministry or what we need in children's ministry. So I'm going to give you a list of some of the opportunities you have to serve in children's ministry if you have a heart for the kids. And you definitely have to have a heart for the kids. But the first thing is a Wednesday evening. Every other Wednesday evening, we need a pre-K teacher and a pre-K helper. And to me, that's the funnest class. That's my favorite class. But also, the commitment is a three-month commitment, and you serve every other week. We also need people to help with the special needs kids. We have a few special needs children that just need that one-on-one. We like to have them in the class with us, but they need more of someone with them so that we can help them along. So if you have a heart for special needs kids, we would love to have you. Also, children's worship. We need children's worship. So you don't have to have a lot of experience. You just need to love kids and love Jesus. And the last thing is puppets. We have these three puppets called Dee, Cy, and Paul. And it's disciple. And we would love to have a puppet ministry for them. So if you have a heart for that, there's lots of other, we always need helpers, we always need extra hands. We're pretty good on teachers except for that pre-K class. But to me, it's the funnest ministry in the church. So if you have a heart for the kids, come see me. I'll be out at a table outside the doors. God bless you.
Thank you. If y'all would open your bulletins and in the middle section there, the Calvary Chapel of the Crosswinds, which they're going to dedicate a new building this evening at 6 p.m., and they have invited our fellowship to come and participate in that if we'd like to. Also, there's a junior high camping trip coming up. Ages 12 through 14 are invited for the overnight trip. They have sign-up information at the booth, and you can talk to Donald or Tish Ruiz about that. And of course, what Nori mentioned about the summer sister dessert coming up, and also you're needed wherever you think you would fit in good here. You just have to have a willing heart and want to serve God. You know, it's important. And also for the sign-ups for the to get plugged in for any ministry you'd like to, you can do that online too as well. Thank you.
We're in the book of Colossians, and
these guys have Bibles. So.
You know what? We need to give Troy another hand because he agreed to do announcements. And I tell you what, man, if anybody ever asks you, if you're in a church somewhere and anybody ever asks you for announcements, run. They're the hardest things to do. And Troy is so full of energy and joy. He's bubbling. But it's hard because eventually you'll start to see it because he's going to get all comfortable up here. But man, it is hard. And you get up here and all of a sudden it's like, open bulletin. Hey, Troy, good job, man. I'm glad to have you. And the funny thing is, like, when I do them, and the reason really is because, one, I'm not supposed to be the jack of all trades. And, you know, I think about the bulletin about 3 seconds before I walk up here. So Troy's going to work on making them interesting and keeping everybody involved and informed. So good job, Troy. Anyways, we're in Colossians chapter 4 this morning. Colossians chapter 4. And we're going to not be finishing Colossians this week. We'll finish Colossians up next week, and then we'll be going into 1 Thessalonians. And so I'm real excited about that and the signs of the times, and we're going to be able to talk a lot about that once we get into 1 Thessalonians. But why don't you go ahead and turn there. We will read verses 5 and 6, pray, and then get into our teaching this morning. Colossians chapter 4, starting at verse 5, and it reads, "Walk in wisdom towards those who are outside, redeeming the time. Let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer each one." Dear Lord, as we live in crazy times, we just acknowledge for you they're not crazy, that you are not worried, that you have a plan, you know the end from the beginning, that you are God. And we are so thankful that as the world flip-flops, changes, swerves, moves, is shaken, that you never change, and that every good and perfect gift comes from you, the Father of lights. And may it be that our lives are stable, that our lives are firm, that our lives are not a mess, because we're attached to you and you are not a mess. And may we lead others and introduce others to you, even as this passage suggests, Lord, that we would learn to walk in wisdom today, God. May this week hold incredible divine appointments that show your word to be true in our lives. We love you, Lord. Just teach us. Help us to be open this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. So we are in the closing section of Colossians, and Paul is making his parting exhortations to the church. And last Sunday, we talked a lot about prayer. In fact, last Sunday, we were in chapter 4, verse 2, 3, and 4, And it reads this, continue earnestly in prayer, being vigilant in it with thanksgiving. Meanwhile, praying also for us that God would open to us a door for the word to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am also in chains, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. And immediately he says, then walk in wisdom. And so we see prayer and then walking in wisdom. And so this morning we're going to see some practical, wise advice on using our speech and behavior as witnessing tools. But I do want you to note that instead of just going out and being a witness, it starts somewhere before that. In fact, as Christians, we need to have a coming out of the closet kind of event. Well, what do you mean, Pastor? That's weird. No, it's not. We come out of the prayer closet and we live our life for God. And so it starts with that personal, intimate, deep relationship with God, and it comes out and it lives practically before mankind. And that's what we're going to look at this morning. But it starts with prayer. And understand, if we truly believe that these are the last days, I do. I mean, it's crazy. I may be wrong, but I'm going to act as though they are. We do need to get busy, and we do need to be serious about the days and the times that we live in. So let's go ahead and look at verse 5 again. Walk in wisdom towards those who are on the outside. Walk in wisdom, or conduct yourself with wisdom towards outsiders. First, let's talk about what wisdom is and what it isn't. First of all, wisdom is not knowledge. Knowledge is something different than wisdom. You see, you can know a lot of stuff, but not know how to apply it. Wisdom is the proper application of knowledge. It's the application of what you know. Quite a few years ago now, I was in California. We were actually preparing to move out here to plant the church. And I was working out at the gym one morning, and I'm sweating, and I look over and I go, man, I know you. It turns out that this guy that was next to me was the little brother of my best friend in high school. I'm like, Danny, how are things going, man? He's like, yeah, they're going great. I go, so what are you doing with your life? He goes, well, I'm a marriage and family counselor. I'm like, great, so you got a wife and kids? He goes, well, I've been divorced twice. So he went to school, got a bachelor's degree, and then a master's degree in marriage and family counseling, and he's been divorced twice. Is that wisdom? A lot of knowledge, though, right? Wisdom is applying knowledge. And so we want to be wise towards those who are unbelievers, non-Christians, or people that are unsaved. So again, a lot of us have knowledge, but do we have wisdom? And so you go to a young person who's in college and they know a lot, right? But we can still call them a dingbat or clueless, right? Because they haven't really applied life to their situation yet. And so we apply knowledge and become wise. But you need to understand something. We can apply false knowledge as well, right? And that's what we're about when you start to trust the Word of God. Because the Word of God has transcendent knowledge. What do I mean? Well, the things that are true in the Bible are true beyond our universe, beyond space and time, and they've always been true forever. What about worldly knowledge? Does it change all the time? We base our life on the facts of worldly knowledge, and our life is going to be a mess and inconsistent, right? And so it's like the world is always moving and changing, and how do you figure this out? You know, right now it's hard to start a business because our government doesn't really have a standard. It's kind of changing all the time. And so if you're starting a business, you can't really foretell what taxes are going to be like next year or what regulations are going to be like next year. What's going to happen? Because you just don't know, because there's no consistency. The Word of God is not like that. And one of the reasons why I just, right now, I'm just doubling down on trusting God and His Word is because I just recognize, finally, you know, just this world is inconsistent. And this world, you know, basing your life on the things of this world cause your life to be radically inconsistent, unfruitful, and frustrating, and empty. And so I'm doubling down on God's truth in my own life. I want us to do that because we can show people His ways don't change and they're perfect in every way. And so we hold on to God's knowledge, God's truth. Scripture tells us to conduct ourselves with wisdom, walk in wisdom, be wise in the way that we act. But what does the Bible say about how we're supposed to act? What is biblical wisdom in the way that we're supposed to act? Well, there's a verse in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 11. He says that you also aspire to lead a quiet life, to mind your own business, and to work with your own hands as we commanded you, that you may walk properly towards those who are outside, and that you may lack nothing. Well, that's interesting, right? Because he talks about the same type of thing. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, it says, live a quiet life and take care of your own business. And what he's saying is, watch your life. That people that look at you from the outside that aren't believers or Christians may see that you're walking properly. And so it says, lead a quiet life and do good work and provide for your family. Because you need to understand that in Christianity, there's a lot of characters who like to stand out and be obnoxious about their Christianity, and then they call themselves witnesses. Let me give you an example. You know, one thing happened once TV got popular and you started having TV evangelists, right? Because TV is a visual medium. You're not just presenting ideas, but you're trying to present an image. And what happened with these evangelists on TV? You know, the women started making prom wear everyday wear, right? These big old poofy dresses and these crazy wild hairdos and tons of jewelry and crazy makeup and eyelashes that reach 4 feet out from their face. You know, it's like, whoa, watch out, man. She's coming in the room. She'll whack you with her eyelashes. Just craziness, right? Is that what Christianity really is? Not to the rest of the world. It's like, that's foolishness. What's the deal? And that station still reaches all over the world, but it's presenting this false form, this outward form. Many times Christians will point fingers at the world and say, why don't you just get your act together? But the world will point back at Christians and they'll say, why don't you get your act together before you start pointing at my act? And so we need to start there, right? Instead of like living as hypocrites, we need to actually start living what we say we believe. And it's weird because we're going to tell the world how they should believe and we're not, or how they should live, and we're not living that way ourselves. And so Paul would exhort us, you walk with God yourself first. You take care of your business, and you are going to draw attention. Others are just all about having the snappy answer, right? But they don't care about the person who's listening. They just want to win the argument. It's a cute saying, and you got them, and you won. And I'm guilty of this. You know, I've been learning a lot of things about answering the world, and I've shared this before, but I was on the beach, and we were talking to someone, and this person said, you know, I'm Buddhist, so I believe everybody's okay. And I accept your beliefs. You should accept mine, too. And so you know what happened all of a sudden? It's like, that made me mad. Because I'd learned a few things. And I'm going to show this guy that he's wrong. And so what I did is I said, so you're Buddhist, and you say you accept everything I believe. Well, the Bible says Jesus is the way, the truth, and life. No man comes to the Father but through him. That's what he said, John 14:6. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but through him. There's one way to God, and that's through Jesus Christ. That's what Jesus says. Do you believe in it? He goes, no. I go, so you're wrong. I won the argument, lost the soul, guys. So do we just need to have quick answers to everybody? I tell you what those quick answers do. They impress yourself and your pride. They impress your friends when you tell it later. Ooh. I'm not telling you that to impress you. It's like your pastor blew it. Because he didn't care about the soul. He cared about himself winning an argument. And that was wrong. But we impress ourselves and we try to impress others that are in our same group, right? Instead of really caring about the person. And so that's another way we're flamboyant. We got the quick answer and we can just nail people. But what does the Bible say? Be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry, right? And I got angry and I was quick to speak and I just shut somebody down. Maybe shut them out of the, I don't know. I mean, God's in control, I guess, but it's like, man. And, you know, even for elders, they must have a good reputation with those outside of the church. So we're not going to put an elder with us here who is just known as an argumentative jerk and people hate his guts. You know, that's not gonna happen. And so we're meant to walk wise to those on the outside to have a good reputation as much as possible. Even use, Paul told Titus in chapter 2, verse 6, exhort the young men to be sober-minded in all things, showing yourself to be a pattern of good works in doctrine, showing integrity, reverence, incorruptibility, sound speech that cannot be condemned, that one who is an opponent may be ashamed, having nothing evil to say of you. And so even the young men, and full of their testosterone and pride, he says, live this way. What about old men? Should we live that way? We're not supposed to be obnoxious jerks to people. We're supposed to learn how to walk in wisdom and to be a witness. Peter said this in 1 Peter 2:12, having your conduct honorable amongst the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. 1 Peter 2:15, for this is the will of God, that by doing good you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men, being the witness in your conduct. 1 Peter 3:16, having a good conscience, that when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed. And so he says, after you pray, go out and walk in wisdom in front of the world, redeeming the time. Walk in a way that is wise. You have the opportunity every day you go out to live as a witness before the world. It's been said that you may be the only gospel message that anybody ever reads. You ever think about that? Every so often I hear a man complaining about all the jerks he works with. All those unbelievers. I want to go into the ministry so I don't have to work with unbelievers. And I look at them and think, you get to be around unbelievers? I got to do other things to be around unbelievers. I'm around believers all the time, and they frustrate me. You know, I want to be around unbelievers. I want to give them the gospel, you know? And you have an opportunity. It was interesting. Between services, I was talking with a couple, and one of the things we decided in the last 2 years is to not be so busy just doing all these outward outreaches, but to be focused on raising disciples in the church, individuals that start off their day presenting their lives to God and fellowshipping with Him. You guys need to understand that's our goal for you, not for you to be busy, but for you to be fellowshippers with God. That's our primary goal here. And so what happened is we stopped doing as many outreaches and bigger things at Cole Park and all these other things that we've done over the years. And we'll still do them, and we have plans to do some of these things in the future, but we're just not doing as many because our goal is to raise disciples. And I think ultimately, if that goal is met, if everybody that's attending this church on a regular basis is having fellowship with God on a daily basis and being his child on a daily basis, everywhere you go is an outreach. Think about that. So we send out 400 people every week as an outreach into 400 different places. How cool is that? Would we be more effective than having one or two big outreaches a year and spending thousands of dollars and maybe reaching just a few instead of you guys going out there as living, acting gospel messages, making a difference in the world? You know, and I think, wow, yeah. That's the way it ought to be. So people might look at us and say, man, you're not so active as a church. No, we may be more active. It's up to God to decide. But we're not trying to impress other churches with our busyness. We want to build the kingdom of God with our lives, where it really makes a difference on a day-to-day basis, right? Everybody can behave at an outreach, I hope, for a couple hours. But if you behave at your job, in your neighborhood, with your family, with your friends, on a day-to-day basis, is it a greater witness in the world? It sure is, right? Now, many of you probably got saved at an evangelistic outreach, but I would say probably all of us were influenced by someone who is actually walking with God in front of us, right? They may have not been the person that led us to Christ, but we watched their lives and we said, wow, this works. And you know who did that for me? My own parents. They raised six kids, six crazy kids, including myself. They went through a lot of heartache and hurt throughout their life, and the Lord was always there for them. And when our lives fell apart as kids, their lives did not fall apart because they had Jesus. They had the rock. And so when it came time, push came to shove, I knew where I had to reach out to. I didn't reach out to Buddha. I reached out to Jesus. And they didn't lead me to Christ or back to Christ or whatever, but they were the reason, because they lived their life in wisdom. Not perfect, but in wisdom before their son. And that makes such a huge difference. And we've all been influenced by people. Okay, so walk in wisdom and redeem the time. The time that you have is an opportunity to witness. Again, cocky and snappy comebacks don't really cut it. Your life is that opportunity to witness. Living what you believe, more than just having snappy comebacks, means that when that opportunity arises for you to speak, you're going to speak with credibility. So we had a young adult fellowship on Friday night, and my wife and I are involved in the young adult fellowship because of the craziness of the world young people face today. I mean, it's nuts. I could not imagine facing what our young people have to face. So I want to be there, and I want to try to equip our young adults as much as possible. So one of the students was saying that there was a person that they just hired at their workplace who wanted to make sure that everybody in that place knew that they lived an active homosexual lifestyle, and was talking about very perverse things to this person that's underage as well. A lot of illegal things, right? Well, how am I supposed to respond to this? Now, our minds are thinking, oh, we can say this, and we can say this, and we can do this, and we can bust them, and we can tell on them, and we can get them, you know, called sexual predators, and it's illegal, and everything else. We can get them fired. Is that walking in wisdom? Remember, James chapter 1, verse 19, be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. And if we want to walk in wisdom, if we say we want to walk like Christ, let's set up an ideal response to that. What do we do? Well, first of all, we're going to listen to what they're saying. We're going to say, wow, this poor person is trying to force their beliefs on everybody else because they're insecure and they're being outward about it. That's too bad. What has now happened? That person's problem is not your problem. You're now thinking logically about the situation. But if you're selfish, what are you saying? They're bugging me and I want to take them out. Is that what Jesus would do? I'm sure glad Jesus didn't do that, because he'd take us all out, right? Because we're all sinners. That's why he came. He didn't come because we were warm and fuzzy and so cute. He came because we were sinners and destined for hell. See how different it is? And if you respond in these ways, you are radically different than those around you. Remember, Jesus came to save sinners, not the perfect. Remember, he was having dinner with tax collectors and sinners, IRS people and hookers is what it meant. Worst of the worst, man. But he was these people that were hated by the culture. He had a meal with them, and he was criticized for that. And that's what he said, I came to save sinners. And so he reached out. He went beyond himself. He was willing to risk his reputation to save a lost soul. And he cared enough to reach out. And was it offensive to his perfection? Well, I'm sure it was. But he understood that what he was there to do. Do we understand why, after you got saved, you weren't just taken up into heaven? Wouldn't that be cool? Get saved, boom, you're gone, you're in heaven. Right on. But that's not what God does, right? You get saved and you actually stay here. Bummer. no opportunity to live a life as a witness in front of other people. And instead of being selfish, you become selfless. That's Christian maturity, right? And so if you walk in wisdom, you want to walk like Christ walked. And you want to walk in a way that you're looking at the opportunity. You're making the most of that opportunity. And so we want to redeem the time. We want to recognize the value of our time. Paul said in Ephesians 5, 15 and 16, be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise, making the most of your time because the days are evil. Listen, since the days are evil, and I would dare say becoming more and more overtly and outwardly evil, the more opportunity we have to live differently. And so instead of that person next to you bugging you because of their habits, you know, that person next to you now becomes an opportunity. Because traditionally at your job, maybe it's such that everybody's looking out for their own and everybody wants to get the raise and everybody wants to get the advancement. That you actually help someone next to you on a project that they're going to get credit for. But you're doing it as unto the Lord. And they know you did it, but the Lord saw it, and the Lord is in charge of your promotion, not man. You do all things heartily as unto the Lord, right? And is he in charge? Does he see? Is he able to advance you? Or do we have to promote ourselves? Do we have to go for the gusto ourselves? You know, as a young man, I learned this. There was a young guy named Steve, and we became good friends, but I was basically discipling Steve. And Steve and I started attending the same church at the same time, and I was discipling him. Now, Steve, he's a pastor today because he has a real loud, obnoxious personality. You know, but he was really loud. If he was here today, you'd know he was here today because he still has this crazy personality. I had lunch with him a couple summers ago, and he's still this wild man. So we go to this church, two young men on fire for the Lord, and both of us are thinking that we're going to be pastors someday, that that's our calling in our life. And I'm discipling him. I'm more mature than him in the Lord. But since he's so loud, everybody notices Steve. Well, a leadership conference was coming up, and the pastors at the church asked Steve to go to the conference, and they didn't ask me. We're both serving in the high school department. And he got asked, and I didn't. And so I go to my wife, and I was like, it's like whiny, cry, like, you know. But one thing I did know was, if God is in charge of your life, you let him do the work. You don't promote yourself. You don't go rebuking people, proving that you're not worthy to be in leadership. You just let God take care of it. And so I totally let it go. Hey, God, you're in charge. If you want to make me a pastor someday, you will make me a pastor. That's your business. I'm going to follow you, and whatever you want to do, that's what we'll do. And so when I finally laid it to rest the day before that retreat took place, one of the assistant pastors comes up to me and goes, hey, Rod, we totally forgot to invite you to the leadership conference. We wanted to invite you. And it was so cool because it was so obviously a lesson from God that you need to learn to be humble, and you need to learn to trust me. And because you know I'm in charge, it doesn't matter. You don't have to step on people and climb the ladder. I'm in charge of you. You don't have to, you know, you don't have to impress men. If you're going to get that advancement, you're going to get that advancement. Man can't stop me. I'm God. Trust me. Now, let me share with you something about Jesus' behavior. And if we want to be like Jesus, we need to implement this in our lives. Remember in John chapter 13, the Bible says there, that Jesus, knowing where he came from and knowing where he was going, he stripped himself down and he washed the disciples' feet. Now, many people just talk about washing the disciples' feet, how he humbled himself. But right before that, it says he knew where he came from and where he was going. Therefore, he was able to put himself in the most humble place because he had absolute confidence in what God had made him. Do you have absolute confidence in what God has made you? Do you have absolute confidence in God's care for your life? The more confidence you have and the more care you have, or the more understanding of God's care for you in your life that you have, the more available you are to do anything for God, no matter what it is. And he sees. Anything done in private, he sees. He knows. And so you go to work and you work for God. And when you're working for God, it doesn't matter. Oh, they're going to get advanced before me. They didn't see. Oh, the boss is coming. You know, better start working. Whatever it is, you know, it's like you don't have to do that. You do things heartily as unto the Lord, and you allow him to be that guy. Therefore, the people you work with are not your competition. The people you work for are your church. They're your ministry. They're your mission field. And you serve God faithfully. And it gives you a footing or a place, an opportunity to minister into their lives. And so, this person's at work, this person's being flamboyant, as opposed to coming up to some snappy thing and saying, God hates homosexuals. Because there's a problem with that, right? When you say that, God hates homosexuals. Wait. Let's back up a little bit. God hates sin. And if you want to put you in that category, that means God hates you too, because you're a sinner. You just have a different sin. So we need to change our message, right? Because we might be proud of ourselves for being so bold, but we're being hateful at times, and we're misrepresenting God. What does that mean? It means that we need to know God's heart more, and we need to learn how to not make other people's problems our problems because we've been offended. If we die to self, we're not easily offended, and we can look at that person like God's looking at them. And so in that situation, if you regather yourself and you pull back and you go, why are they doing this? Well, they're doing this because they're very insecure in their behavior. They're very insecure in who they are, and they're trying to grab everybody else to agree with them. And if you don't agree with them, they're going to scream. This poor person, Lord, how do you want me to respond to this? Now, their behavior's bad. You still got to deal with it with the company, because one, if they're talking in a sexual way to a minor, it doesn't matter if they're homosexual or not. They can be pegged as a sexual offender for the rest of their life, right? That company can also get sued. Now, I'm not expecting that person to bring a lawsuit against that company, but someone else might if that behavior continues with other people, right? And so it's not that you completely ignore and do the wrong thing, but you tell that person, listen, that's inappropriate to talk like that. You know, and they continue, you go to the, you know, and you try to correct it before trashing their life. But what do we do when we're selfish? What do we do when we're not being wise? Oh, they're bugging me, I'm gonna get them, oh, lawsuit, it's coming. And what are you acting like? Everybody else. You're not acting like Christ with wisdom. Okay? And so we have this incredible opportunity. And you need to understand this. You don't need to live flamboyantly to attract attention. Because if you're working at a job and you haven't been, you know, I'm a Christian and wearing the Christian t-shirt or whatever, you know, you go to your job and you say you say a bad word, everybody's going to go, oh, I thought you were a Christian. And you didn't even tell them, right? Just because you are a Christian, you are going to attract attention if you're living a Christian life, right? If you are honest, if you're on time, if you're quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, if you're living your life with grace towards other people, if you're helping other people, if you're helping your boss succeed at his job because that's what you've been hired to do, if you're living a Christian life, you are drawing a ton of attention, right? No matter what, you already are. And if you're not, you probably ought to try to live a Christian life at your job, because you will. People know. And have you guys noticed people watch you? They totally watch you. So while we're so busy telling the world how to live, the world's actually looking at us like, I'll listen to you as soon as you figure your life out yourself. But if you're living your life, they're going to come to you and they're going to ask you, what's the deal? Why are you so different? Or how did you do this differently? And so sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. Sanctify him. Live differently on a day-to-day basis. And you are an evangelist. Now, you are supposed to use words, because there's two extremes, right? I'm just living my Christian life, and that's my witness. And then there's others who say, well, I'm out there preaching, but they're not living a Christian life at all, right? So those are the two extremes. Listen, you need to be both. You need to live a Christian life, and then on the tip of your tongue, you need to have the gospel, the words of life, ready to go. Because if you're living the life, the opportunity is going to come. Or God will open up the opportunity for you to bring it up. And I'm talking about those people that watch your life. My parents were a huge witness in my life because I got to watch them all the time. A school teacher that's a Christian is a huge influence in your life because you watch them over a year, right? Now, the person just approaching you on the street with the gospel can give you the words of life, but you don't know what their life is about. So it's nowhere near as effective as living your life in front of people. But you got to be willing to share the words as well. You got to be willing to share words with people. And so Paul tells us that right here. He tells us, let your speech, verse 6, back in Colossians 4, always be with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer each one. Judging the world for not being a Christian or for holding Christian morals doesn't do much good, does it? You know, it's like telling kids, stop acting like children. We're children. You know, it's like my wife looking at me, stop acting like a man. I am, you know, and, sorry. I can't not be what I am. And so a sinner can't not be a sinner, but we try to tell them not to be a sinner. The problem is if a sinner starts acting like a Christian, they're still going to hell because they need to be a Christian before they can truly have any credit for acting like a Christian, right? They need to know Jesus. And so let your words be seasoned with grace. And grace, in its definition, is unmerited favor. Do you give people around you the benefit of the doubt? Do you give them blessing when they don't deserve it? Do you give them peace, kind, blessing words when they don't deserve it? It's unmerited favor. So our speech as Christians needs to be filled with grace. And we also need to be sharing the truth. I just love those situations where people are just hanging out. The beach, the park, you know, airplanes, airports are just waiting. You know, you get that opportunity to engage yourself with people. And so, what do you know? I'm a pastor. Well, I don't believe in the Bible because, you know, people in my old church, they hurt me. Well, that's stupid. God never asked you to follow people. He asked you to follow him. It's true, right? It's not grace, though, is it? So someone says that, I don't believe in the Bible because those Christians, man, I was hurt in church. And you go, yeah, I've been hurt in church too. In fact, I'm a pastor and I've hurt people in church. And I don't mean to, but I've done it. It's real. But you know what I found? I found that when people let me down, God never does. And ultimately, he's the one that died for me and I follow him. And then I realized the church is a bunch of goofballs that are trying to do something holy, and we don't always get it right. And people get hurt. Same message, right? But one is a graceful message, and the other is a selfish message because I got on the defensive, and I didn't care about them. I cared about me at the moment. But Christ cares about us. That's why he came and died, right? He left the throne room of heaven, and he came and died for us because he cared more about our needs than his own. Grace allows us just to go, let's talk about that. It's way different. With grace. And we also need to have it be seasoned with salt. Jesus told us we're to be the salt of the world. Preservatives. You know what something else salt does? Besides keeping things from spoiling, salt pulls out the flavor, pulls out the best in food, right? Now, I eat a lot of eggs. But I tell you what, eggs with salt are way different than eggs without salt. I mean, the first thing I want is salt on my eggs. And I can eat a lot of it because I still run and I sweat a lot. So I can eat salt, you know, it's not going to kill me. But the salt, just a little taste of what is good that you give people, they might want more. Are you speaking God's truth? You know? Or are you separating yourself from that person and condemning them? Or are you putting yourself in that person's place and going, wow, I do understand those feelings. And this is what God told to me. Oh, that's in the Bible? Yeah, it's in the Bible. You know, it's so funny. I do marriage counseling quite a bit, and I always talk about how men want to be respected, right? We're all about respect. The Bible says that, right? Wives, submit to your husbands. That's what we need to be happy. Bible says that. Really? Bible says that? Yeah. The love language for men is respect. That's, man, you respect me, you love me. Don't tell me I'm cute. Don't say those pants look cute on you, Pastor. Respect me, and you show that you love me. Don't bring me dead weeds that bloom. Respect me. Those are flowers, dead weeds that bloom. But respect me, and you love me, right? We need that because we represent strength. Ladies, you represent beauty. You want to be cherished and appreciated. You want someone just to appreciate your beauty. And you are emotionally, spiritually, and physically beautiful. And you want to be appreciated for that. I always look around. Women can wear the most flamboyant, crazy things. And women, oh, that's so cute. If a guy wore that, whoa. But women represent beauty. They can pull that off. And I'm not fighting against it. I love that. My wife, my daughters are beautiful. And I totally appreciate that, you know? But I want them to respect me. My daughters know, man, as soon as they disrespect dad, oh, man, it's miserable. Because I just need to be respected. It's in the Bible. So when I tell people, I say, that's, yeah, Bible has a lot of wisdom, right? Hand it out. It's seasoned with salt. Let them desire that truth. It makes people thirsty. Our words need to be filled with grace and seasoned with salt. And you're going to open doors to witness. Every word that comes out of your mouth is a witness. It doesn't have to be all about sharing, but just grace in every situation. So a mouth controlled by the wisdom of God and by the power of the Spirit is a powerful witness, isn't it? It's a powerful witness because people use words for all kinds of other crazy things, right? How fast can you ruin your witness with your words? Like that, right? Let me share with you something about your words. In order for you to use your words wisely as a witness, you need to have the words of wisdom. That means you don't ignore your Bible. Don't ignore your Bible. You know, ancient people were nuts. And they needed God. And there's tons of situations and stories in the Bible where people do really stupid things, just like they do really stupid things today. People needed God back then, and we read the stories. And people need God today, and they need to hear the stories. If you're going to give people salty words of grace, you need to put the raw material in you so you can use it. But there's another side to it, because you can give them truth without love, and that would be very harsh. Because can you beat up people with the Word of God? Oh, yeah, you can whack them with the Word of God. And so you also need to be filled with the Spirit in order to learn how to use those words in a grace-filled way as well, right? So the Word and the Spirit. And I liken it to this. If you were building a house and they dumped all the materials in a pile and you didn't have the builder, what are you going to have? Pile of junk, right? You have all the material there. But if you don't have the builder, you just have a pile of junk. Something's useless. What if the builder shows up on the building site, on the construction site, and there's no material there? He's also useless, right? And so you got this one extreme where people are focused on the Spirit, but they're not being filled up with the tools of the Word of God, and we think they're crazy because there's no substance there, but a lot of activity. And then you got others that are just all about the material, and they know it, but it's just sitting there, and it's not applied in a spiritual way. And so you take the master builder, and you take the raw material of the Word, and you place them together, and you have a witness. You have a construction of something awesome. And so you got the words of God, and then led by the Spirit of God, and you're able to be a witness. So what does that mean? Spend time with God in His Word every day, and pray that the Spirit lead you and fill you and teach you how to walk in wisdom with your conduct and with your words. Abraham lied when he went down to Egypt with his wife. Tell him you're my sister. Wrong, right? You know what the Pharaoh did? He rebuked the father of faith. Oh, did he learn his lesson completely? No, because he did the same thing to a guy named Abimelech, and Abimelech then rebuked him for what he did. Oh, that hurts to see. I mean, he did a lot of awesome things, but that's just an example how a godly guy ruined his witness by his conduct and his words. A man named Peake said this: they must strive to cultivate the gift of pleasant and wise conversation so that they may be able to speak appropriately to each individual with his particular needs, with whom they come in contact. Listen, I would pray that each one of us will begin to consider our witness in this community. I shared with you our master plan of evangelism and outreach in this church. And it is this: you are God's witness. What about you, Pastor? I do my part. I go surfing. I play disc golf. I go to the gym. But I work here. I'm supposed to be equipping you for the works of service. You are a pastor, evangelist, teacher, example, gospel message, word of God everywhere you go. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. What does that mean? It means as you go out, it is a much greater outreach than just on October 31st having a carnival. Now, we were going to do that this year, but we're not able to. The person that was doing it isn't going to help us anymore, so we're doing something else. But that's a one-time outreach. We can all behave for a couple hours, look good, and a few people might get saved. But what happens if the 400 members of this church spend daily time with Jesus, become less and less selfish and become selfless, and actually care and look at those people around them and consider themselves evangelists everywhere they go, and their life a billboard for the grace of God? Are many more lives going to be changed? Right? They will be. And again, I'm not saying it's bad to do outreach evangelism, but you are the outreach evangelism for God. Go into all the world and make disciples, baptizing them and teaching them, right? Who's that written to? Well, if you read it, it's written to you. You go and you make a difference. But I'm telling you, the wisdom is in the way you live. And the wisdom is in the words that you use. It's different. It is so different than what we're being handed in the Christian stage in America right now. It's so different than the stereotypical way people expect you to act as a Christian. One day I was ministering to a homosexual activist who led Queer Nation at Berkeley campus. And he was off for the summer. He was at the church, and he came, and he wanted to speak to me. And he came 3 times that summer. It was so weird. He kept on coming back, and he looked at me, and he said, "You're supposed to hate me, and you don't, and that makes me mad." Guys, you should confound people. You should confound people like that. Grace. You're still going to hold on to the truth, but man, you get in there with grace, right? And with salt and the light of your life. Make a difference, man. You guys have marching orders. We're not a church, you know. Right now, you're listening and watching. That should be the only time we do this, guys. Because I'm not the church. Jim and Noreen and Rosemary and Jeremy, and they're not the church. We're the church. And we're a church where the Bible says, you know, you have a pastor teacher to equip the saints for works of ministry. It doesn't say pastor teacher should do all the works of ministry and everybody else should watch. It says you're to equip the saints, Ephesians 4, 11 and 12, for works of ministry or works of service, that the body of Christ may be built up into that perfect man, into the fullness of the stature of Jesus Christ, not tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine, that we're solidified because we're all walking with Jesus, not because you have to sign a piece of paper that says, I agree. We're all solidified and unified because we know the same God and Savior, and we all spend time with him every day. And it's so cool when you start thinking something and everybody goes, I was thinking that too. Well, go figure. We have the same boss. And so it's your marching orders. It isn't, you know, an audience observing Christianity take place. It's Christianity taking place. You know, at times we've had signs that said, you are now entering your mission field. I'm going to say it even different. You're now entering your church where you're pastoring. And you may be a janitor pastor. You may be a doctor pastor. You may be a lawyer pastor. That'd be rare. But a teacher, a homemaker pastor, a neighbor pastor, whatever you are called to go out and make a difference. And how cool is it going to be in heaven? I can't wait for some things in heaven, because I understand it, that there's going to be people that come up to me and thank me, and I don't even know who they are. I want everybody in this life to have those, because there's going to be people I hunt down. This guy, when I was backslidden in college, he used to always force himself to be my lab partner in all my biology classes. And I couldn't remember his name for the life of me. About 6 months ago, I looked up his name, because he knew I was a backslidden Christian, and he just wanted to be with me, and he invited me to church all the time and pester me in every activity and everything else, and he just kept on bugging me, and it bugged me because I couldn't remember his name. I finally remember his name, and I found him on Facebook, and I connected with him, and I go, thank you so much, dude. I love you, man. It was so cool. And I went on the surfing tour, and he actually got into motocross, and he did the motocross tour for years and stuff, you know, so it was interesting, but it was just neat. But I want my life to be like that. When I get into heaven, I want people to be able to come up. Man, you don't know me, but when we were out surfing one day, you don't know me, but we were on the disc golf course, and you sat down and talked to me, and I was going through a hard time, and you prayed with me. You probably don't remember me, but we were at the gym, and you were next to me sweating on the stair stepper. You know, you may not remember, but on this one job, you went away from your job, and I was just, you know, emptying trash cans, and you spent time with me, and you treated me like a human, and no one else did. Right? Be that guy. Don't watch Christianity happen. Live Christianity. And Christianity is not lived by the TV evangelists. Christianity is lived by the homeschooling mom, the divorced woman or the widow, the man who just lost his job. That's where it's really lived, right? Let people see it and truly make a difference. And that's my prayer for you this week. I'd love to have you guys come. Oh, it was so cool. Last week, this is what happened. Because God starts using you in an incredible way. Dear God, bless these people. Bless us as a church, as a body. Fill us with your spirit, your wisdom, your knowledge, Lord. Help us to catch your vision for our daily life, God. The Bible says that you know your plans for us. May we know your plans for us as well. It says that you've laid out things for us to fulfill, that you've prepared us to do. Lord, may we find them. May we see them. May we be willing to step into those open doors that you've given us. May we live as a witness in our conduct and in our words, and may we be radically different, that we may attract attention with your light, not with our own, God. Oh, may we be different. May we be a peculiar people, that we may draw people to you. We love you, Lord. We love your word. We love your stability. We love your strength. Just bless us this week. Blow our minds, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, we're going to go ahead and close with a little bit of worship. It's also a time to worship the Lord through tithes and offerings, if you so desire to do so. It's also a time for prayer, and so we'll have opportunities for you guys to come up for prayer. We love to pray with you, and we love to watch prayer work. You know, I've been talking with my wife, just like, I want to see answered prayers. And the thing is, sometimes if you're not consistent in your prayer and God does something, sometimes, well, maybe he would have done it anyways. I don't want to be that guy. I want to be persistent in specific prayers to see what God might do in a situation so that I can just go, yes. And the Bible says you do not have because you do not ask. Don't be that guy. And so we'd love to pray with you and for you. If you don't know Jesus as your Savior, we'd love to pray with you to come to know Jesus as your Savior. Today is the day to do that. Don't wait for tomorrow. Man, this world is nuts. You need Jesus now. He's not nuts. He is always perfect and always faithful. And so we'd love to pray with you for that as well. So let's go ahead and worship the Lord together. God bless you guys.
Jesus, you are so wonderful. So wonderful in all your ways. The highest praise is yours alone. You are so wonderful. So wonderful you are. Jesus, you are so beautiful. So beautiful that you outshine the brightest light. There's no one like you. You are so beautiful. So beautiful you are. My life will burn for you. Cause your light shined in the darkness. I was hopeless and you lifted up my head to sing for joy with a song that broke the silence of my worship. Now I'm singing all the day and forevermore. You will be adored because you are wonderful. Jesus, you are magnificent. Everywhere, cause you are magnificent, magnificent you are. My life will burn for you, cause your light shined in the darkness. I was so blessed and you lifted up my head. Sing for joy with a song that breaks the silence of my worship. Now I'm singing all the day and forevermore. You will be adored because you are wonderful.
My life will burn for you.
And my life will burn for you. Hopeless, and you lifted up my head to sing for joy with a song that breaks the silence of my worship. Now singing all the day and forevermore, you will be adored because you are.
Jesus, you are wonderful, God. The highest praise belongs to you. You are magnificent and so beautiful, God. Thank you for revealing yourself to us. We ask, Lord, that throughout this day you would help us to keep our eyes focused on you, that you would please open our eyes to see you throughout this day. Remind us, God, of the things you've taught us today, and let it get deep down in our soul, Lord, that we won't forget, that we'll remember. And Lord, that we would have that extra measure of grace and faith and ability to do what you are revealing to us to do. We thank you and we praise you again for this time, and we pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Have a very blessed day. We have another song of worship that we'll do, and please stay and worship with us. If you need to get your children, now's the time to do that, but please come back if you can't. All right.
As morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of praise that rise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. In your name we pray. Come and fill our hearts today. Lord, give us strength to live for you and glorify your name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save. Your name. Shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save. Your name.
Y'all. Yeah. Yeah, turning it up really helps.
Did that help?
I could barely hear it to strum with you earlier.
Maybe next time.
That's what it is.